On the news, counter-terror police have launched a national campaign to try to stop Britons travelling to Syria to fight in the country's civil war. Their appeal is particularly aimed at women who might be concerned about young men planning to go there. Joined by Asim Qureshi from the human rights group CAGE, and in central London, we can speak to Emily Dyer from the think tank, the Henry Jackson Society. Emily, to you first, if I may. Explain to us your point of view on this.
I think that this scheme is a clear example of the police working with Muslim communities in Britain to help prevent members of their family travelling abroad and potentially harming themselves and others, and I think it should be supported.
You disagree?
I don't necessarily disagree. What I say, though, that this is a little bit carrot and stick, in the sense that the police are sending out a dual message, which is, one is, you know, work with us to stop young people from growing abroad, but at the same time, you know, threatening communities by saying, well, actually, you could potentially be accomplices to these young men going abroad if you don't report them, if you have any kind of inclination that they're going abroad. So what it does actually is that it kind of strikes fear within the community, not knowing what they really should and shouldn't be doing. But I think more than that, what this is going to do is that it's going to bring about a climate of fear amongst young people in relation to their families, in relation to being able to talk to them freely about, you know, their feelings, about, you know, their concerns regarding conflicts such as Syria, and really becoming introverted, which is actually the last thing that we want to do. Because when people become introverted, they're more likely to feel isolated, to become alienated from political processes. And what we say is actually we need to open that discussion up and allow people to be able to talk about these things. The police, you know, kind of securitizing this entire issue is actually making things harder. And what we need to do actually is do what we're already doing. Muslim communities, scholars, leaders, they're already speaking to young people and saying, look, fine, we agree that it's an ethical thing to try and fight against injustice, but we don't believe that actually going out there and fighting is necessarily the best step to take. And I think that is the kind of approach that needs to continue, that should continue happening.
Emily?
I don't think this is about the criminalization of young Muslims. This is about supporting their families in supporting them. At no point have these families been threatened. In fact, they've actually been offered another path of support to go to. They don't have to just rely on their own powers of persuasion or attempts to help their family relatives. They actually have the government and the police behind them as a method of support. This isn't about the victimization or the criminalization of young Muslims. This is not a witch hunt. This is about protecting the next generation of young British Muslims from going abroad and being sucked into a conflict and potentially exacerbating that conflict, as well as returning home and potentially causing harm to other British citizens.
So, Asim, it's not the police and the authorities saying shop your sons to us. It's about offering guidance and advice.
I think guidance advice is great, but the reality is it's how it's perceived as well, and this is being perceived by many people in various communities as being a spying program. I mean, if it gets to a stage where you can't trust your mother, you can't trust your wife in terms of being able to be open with them, then that's going to be damaging in the long run. And, you know, even in terms of then the wider issues regarding the consequences of these young men going out, I think that still needs to be drawn out even further, because all of the information that we're getting back from the front lines over there is that actually people don't want to come back. And further than that, if they do, they definitely don't want to commit acts of terrorism here in the UK. So I think we need a little bit more of a nuanced debate and discussion.
That's over completely opposite to what the Prime Minister has been saying.
Well, I mean, you know, I think the Prime Minister has got his facts wrong, quite frankly. And I think that he's not talking empirically when he's analysing this issue. Look, we had a number of Muslim men going in the 70s, 80s and 90s to conflicts in Afghanistan, in Bosnia, in many places in the world. None of them came back to do this. CAGE did a study of all of the terrorism plots, the actual plots that took place in the UK post 9/11. And out of the 12 plots, six, and the 66 individuals involved, only two had been previously involved in conflicts. But those were not the reason why they did. They wanted to commit acts of terrorism here in the UK. It was purely because of their foreign policy grievances. The reason why we're seeing such large numbers of young Muslim men going over to Syria is because they felt that there wasn't any conflict between their status here in the UK and the conflict that's going over there. That's why when you look at Afghanistan and Iraq post 9/11, you don't see anywhere near the same numbers, because people felt, young Muslims felt, that there's a conflict, there's a between our status as British citizens and our desire to see some kind of change in relation to.
But to all intents and purposes, isn't it a mercenary action that they're taking?
Sorry,
isn't it a mercenary action that they're taking?
It's not a mercenary action. I mean, there's plenty of examples throughout history and modern history of people going over to conflicts in order to assist where they feel that there is oppression taking place against people. And I think there's nothing necessarily wrong, or and there's definitely nothing unethical about that. Of course, people should be concerned about, you know, what these people are going to do. But I don't think it should be assumed that they're going to come back here and commit acts of terrorism, because the statistics and the figures from previous conflicts don't add up in relation to that.
Emily?
I think the government is perfectly right to be cautious. If we want to start talking about empirical statistics, a study by Thomas Heghammer says that 1 in 9 foreign fighters from previous conflicts returned for a terrorist attack. And, you know, while it's perfectly ethical to care about the suffering of innocent Syrian civilians, and another recent study claims that 55% of foreign fighters from the West and Europe end up joining ISIS, which is a very dangerous terrorist group. Over 2/3 of these individuals end up joining ISIS or Jabhat al-Nusra. These are two terrorist groups who have both, at some point or another, had formal ties with al-Qaeda. And I think it's the government's, not only their right, but their duty to be extremely concerned about the risk of foreign fighters returning back to Britain and potentially launching an attack or encouraging others to do the same.
Well, I mean, as President Obama said, not every single form of al-Qaeda is the same. You know, he's even recognizing that there's differences between them. Look, I'm not promoting anybody go and join ISIS or Jabhat al-Nusra. Especially with ISIS, there are many issues there that I think really need to be looked at. What we're talking about here is people coming back here to the UK. And so far, we have not had any indication. You know, the quote of Thomas Heghammer. Heghammer's assessment was done Europe-wide. It wasn't done based on the UK. We just looked at the UK alone, because that's what we're concerned about here, the threat to the UK specifically. Now, obviously, if it seemed like people were going to come back here and commit acts of terrorism, that's
a
problem.
Young British men going to a foreign country and losing their lives, surely we have to be concerned about that as well, don't
No,
we?
That's right, but that's their prerogative. In, you know, if they want to risk their lives in order to defend something that actually, you know, is worthwhile defending, which is the lives of people who are suffering or in pain, then, you know, while we don't say, yes, you should go out there and promote that, because we actually believe that things can be done from over here to help the Syrian people, they shouldn't be criminalized for it. They shouldn't be condemned for it. In fact, what they should be helped to say that, okay, fine, you know, you've done this thing, you've come back home now, how can we help you to reintegrate you back into society? So if there was any trauma that you faced while you were out there, how can we assist you in terms of getting over that? But to assume, to come with the assumption that these people are out now to get the UK just because they've been to the conflict zone, I think that's wrong, and I think that sends the wrong message to our communities as well, who all have a concern about what's going on in Syria.
And how comfortable do you feel with that, Emily?
Well, I would actually disagree with that. Not only do foreign fighters from Britain go over, they not only pose a harm to themselves, it's not as simple as just saying these are rebel groups fighting against the Assad regime. These are rebel groups that are also fighting against each other, and Jabhat al-Nusra and ISIS, as I go back to the 55%, the 2/3 of European and Western individuals that end up joining these groups do not seem to care about the innocent suffering of Muslims. All you have to do is go online and look at the large extent of atrocities that have been carried out against innocent civilians. And so I think if people do care about the innocent suffering of Syrian Muslims, there are the government and that have provided plenty of legitimate ways to go forward and help these civilians, instead of going abroad and joining terrorist organizations and carrying out attacks not just against the Assad regime but against one another and innocent civilians.
Final word to you, Asim.
Look, the reality is that what we've been saying from the very beginning is that we have an entire international legal system that has been established in order to convict acts of criminality. It's called the Geneva Conventions, where people are committing war crimes, where they're kidnapping journalists, where they're targeting civilians. We should be prosecuting people, which has universal jurisdiction. They can be prosecuted anywhere in the world. They should be prosecuted under that, because even under Islamic law, under any system of laws, those kinds of actions are completely unacceptable. And so that is the regime. But to securitize the whole thing and bring it within the realm of counterterrorism skews the debate. This is an internal armed conflict that's happening, one that is similar to many situations around the world. And to start now saying that, well, no longer the Geneva Conventions apply, actually results in a much more difficult situation worldwide, where people will stop respecting that system of laws.
Great to talk to you. Thanks to Emily joining us there down in Millbank. Thank you both.